Welcome, friends. No matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here at Lyndhurst United Church of Christ, where God is still speaking. Welcome if you're joining us on your computer this morning, or your tablet, or you're here in the sanctuary with us. Welcome if you're looking forward to the week ahead, or maybe you're a little concerned about some of the things that are coming up this week, or maybe a little bit of both. Welcome if you're rejoicing today or hurting today, somewhere in your body or in your spirit. Welcome if your experience of God feels like being lost in the wilderness and wandering in circles, or if you experience God in those quiet moments of delight in your life, maybe a little bit of both. Welcome if you're struggling with a mental health or a physical or medical challenge. And I will bring up the words of our mission statement. Please join me. Welcome to Lyndhurst United Church of Christ, where we are faithful to loving and honoring the still speaking God while serving our community and welcoming everyone. So it is a blessing and a joy this morning to welcome the Reverend Diane Vago from the Christian Appalachian Project and a UCC pastor here in our association. Welcome this morning. And it is a blessing and a joy to welcome Regina back into church. We are so glad to have you here this morning and so glad that you have healed so well. You should have seen her walking down that hallway. She was almost as fast as I was. So welcome. So I invite you this morning to take a deep breath. Hold that breath for just a moment. Breathe in peace and breathe out love as we surround our congregation. Take a deep breath. And I invite you to join me in our call to worship for this morning. I love the Lord. God hears my voice and my prayer for mercy. Death wrapped its robes around me. The terrors of the grave overtook me. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Please, Lord, save me. Let us worship God with our hearts, hands, and voices this morning. So about once a month, we do an affirmation of faith, and we rotate through four different affirmations of faith. So this month, it is the Apostles' Creed. So I invite you to join me in reading this responsively. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Amen.
Amen. And I invite you to stand for our opening hymn this morning, Ours the Journey.
Thank you.
be seated. All right, and I'm going to invite Reverend Vago to come forward and join us for a mission moment.
You need to move this up a little bit. You're a little taller than me, and let's move that up a little bit. You should be good.
Thank you so much. Well, thank you, Lynhurst, and thank you, Reverend Monica. It's so good to be here with all of you. I am Diane Vago, Reverend Diane Vago from Christian Appalachian Project. Before I begin, and my moment will be brief, I want to thank you for your kindness and your generosity. I see the nice, beautiful stack of socks and washcloths that will be put to good use at Christian Appalachian Project, so we thank you. In the 90s, years ago, I went to my principal. I was a high school teacher at the time, and I said, Ernie, I want to take students to Appalachia to do service projects to help people in need. He said, if you've got the project in order, chaperones and permission slips, you have my blessing. Friends, here at Lynhurst, 30 years ago, I came with students from Illinois to do service projects in Appalachia. And there I met Christian Appalachian Project. Today, I'm blessed to be the church and community relations coordinator with Christian Appalachian Project. Christian Appalachian Project, our mission is to build hope, to transform lives, and to share Christ's love. That's what we do. And mostly we do that work in Appalachia, here in Kentucky, and in the Appalachian region. We do it through our service programs, elderly services, youth empowerment, housing repair, and through operation sharing. There's a lot I could speak about, but I told you I would be brief. So I just have a short story for you. We have youth empowerment programs and mission trips, right? And this means that students come in the summer for a camp. Students come from the Appalachian region to our camps. My story today is about Bobby. Bobby came to our camp, was so excited to do so. He knew he needed a suitcase, and he told his mom, I can't wait to go to camp. And Bobby showed up with all the other campers with his suitcase. Well, I have to tell you that Bobby was so excited to have that suitcase and be with us that everywhere he went, he took his suitcase with. So for breakfast, he'd be there with the suitcase. And for the afternoon activities, he'd be there with the suitcase. Everywhere he went, he took the suitcase. And then at some point, Turtle, one of my colleagues, that's her camp name, she decided to approach Bobby and take him to the dorm and just sit with him and say, Bobby, I love your little suitcase here, but you're welcome. Please, Bobby, just unpack and join us. Bobby looked at her, and then he looked down at the suitcase. His eyes got puffy and his face red. He said, I don't have anything in it. Turtle took that moment, took that case, and they went to the place next door to the camp area where we have things like socks. And he went shopping, and they filled up that case so that when he could go back to his dorm room, he had something to put on the shelves and something to take home. My friends, those here at Lynhurst and in other parts of the country, Christian Appalachian Project needs you. We serve many children in need, many elderly in need, and we have been doing it since the 60s. Reverend Biden got us started, and we're going strong. So your donations today will make a difference. I thank you, I appreciate you, and I want to invite you to consider volunteering with us. We do have volunteer opportunities, and not so far away. So if you're ever interested, we accept volunteers, young and old, people who volunteer just for a day or an afternoon. We accept gifts in kind and monetary donations. My sisters and brothers, thank you for this time, and thank you for helping people like Bobby. He's just one story. I have a few others when we have some time. Thank you so much.
So what we're going to do is take a moment to bless the socks and the washcloths that we are going to send back with Reverend Diane. So I'm trying to remember the numbers. I think we collected 184 pairs of socks and 148 washcloths. We also collected 66 deodorants for the high school next door. So we're going to bless all of these so that those who use the washcloths and wear the socks know that somebody loved them enough to make donations, and they are blessed. So I invite you to join me in a moment of prayer. Gracious God, we ask your blessings upon the washcloths and the socks that will go forth from Lyndhurst, who will go forth from Louisville to serve those who need them. May the person who uses each washcloth to wash their face and their hands know that someone loves them and that you love them. May each person that puts on one of these pairs of socks, maybe even packs it in a new suitcase, will know that they are loved, that they will know that they are a beloved child of God. May your blessings go with these things that represent our love and our care. Amen. Thank you all for all of your donations. All right, Eva, let me bring up the PowerPoint. Okay, and you know how to flip this.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, our first reading this morning is from Psalms 116, verses 10 through 17.
Let's put this up a little because you're taller than me, too.
I believed in you, so I said, I am deeply troubled, Lord. In my anxiety, I cried out to you. These people are all liars. What can I offer the Lord for all he has done for me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and praise the Lord's name for saving me. I will keep my promises to the Lord in the presence of all his people. The Lord cares deeply when his loved ones die. O Lord, I am your servant. Yes, I am your servant, born into your household. You have freed me from my chains. I will offer you a sacrifice of thanksgiving and call on the name of the Lord. The second reading is from Luke 24, verses 13 through 35. That same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. As they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them, but God kept them from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing so intently as you walk along?" They stopped short, sadness written across their faces. Then one of them, Cleopas, replied, "You must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened there the last few days." "What things?" Jesus asked. "The things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth," they said. "He was a prophet who did powerful miracles, and he was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. But our leading priests and other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped he was the Messiah who had come to rescue Israel. This all happened 3 days ago." Then some women from our group of his followers were at his tomb early this morning, and they came back with an amazing report. They said his body was missing, and they had seen angels who told them Jesus is alive. Some of our men ran out to see, and sure enough, his body was gone, just as the women had said. Then Jesus said to them, "You foolish people, you find it so hard to believe all that the prophets wrote in the scriptures. Wasn't it clearly predicted that the Messiah would have to suffer all these things before entering his glory? Then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets, explaining from all the scriptures the things concerning himself. By this time, they were nearing Emmaus and the end of the journey. Jesus acted as if he were going on, but they begged him, "Stay the night with us, since it is getting late." So he went home with them. As they sat down to eat, he took the bread and blessed it. Then he broke it and gave it to them. Suddenly their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And at that moment, he disappeared. They said to each other, "Didn't our hearts burn within us as he talked with us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?" And within the hour, they were on their way back to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 disciples and the others who had gathered with them, who said, "The Lord has really risen. He appeared to Peter." Then the two from Emmaus told their story of how Jesus had appeared to them as they were walking along the road, and how they had recognized him as he was breaking the bread. This is the good news.
Praise to you, Lord.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you, choir. Okay. All right, we should be ready.
Well, again, it's good to be here with all of you. Thank you so much for the invitation. I have to say I've been moved by the playing and the singing. And of course, I've known Monica for a while, and she's amazing. And then, and she didn't pay me to say this, and then I meet Regina. And Regina, if I had met you before, you probably would have been at the heart of my sermon, but I'm just meeting you now. So I'm so happy to see that you're with us. And can we give her a round of applause, please? Resurrection's happening everywhere, you know. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the dedication of all our hearts give you glory, honor, and praise. You, O Divine Spirit, you, O Holy One, are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. The gospel I chose for this Sunday is in the lectionary. And again, it's an honor to be here, but sometimes when you come, you don't know the church that well. So some churches say you can pick whatever reading, others like to do the lectionary. Monica, do you mostly follow the lectionary? Okay, so we're kind of the same ilk. So I chose the reading from Luke 24, 13 to 25 from the lectionary. And this story, or pericope, follows the resurrection in Luke's gospel. I say this because I found from Monica, Reverend Monica, that the gospel you took last Sunday was from John, right? And that gospel dealing with doubting Thomas, right, is from another gospel. That's a different gospel story, right? When I was growing up and I used to go to church, and on Sunday you'd hear this Thomas story and then the next story, somehow I thought they were all connected, like from the same gospel. And our resurrection stories are similar, but different, right? And so I just want to kind of remind us that we're not in John today, we're in Luke. And what is following our gospel, which is important, is what I'm going to read right now. To refresh our memories, in Luke 24, 1 to 12, the women took spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. At the entrance, the stone was rolled away, but when they entered, they did not find the body. Two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. The men said, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen." After this experience, the women go and tell the 11 what happened. But in verse 11 of chapter 24, we learn that the 11 disciples, apostles, they did not believe the women, because their words seemed like nonsense. I wanted to start this way because in seminary, when I studied, they made a special emphasis on the fact that we have to put a story in context, right? And Cleopas and his companion do talk about this story, but we see it right in the gospel, huh? Right before the current story that we're dealing with this morning. You know, in first century, a woman's testimony did not mean much. For example, in Roman law, we read the woman is incapable of being a witness in any form of jurisprudence where witnesses are required. Women were reckoned with minors and slaves, the dumb and criminals, and incapable of being witnesses. This was because of the infirmity of their sex and because of the ignorance pertaining to public life. Both the Talmud and the historian Josephus concur. So you and I might be puzzled by Cleopas and his friend's response to what happened in the days following the crucifixion, but the women, they met some angels, angelic presence. They saw nobody, but this is the only real testimony they have at this point. I mean, Cleophas and his friend say that. So even though Peter goes into the tomb to verify, Peter sees no angelic influence at that time, and he sees linen, and scripture tells us Peter's left wondering. So the men are puzzled, right? And they're walking with Jesus on this road, right? And they're puzzled, and they think the plan, they thought this plan for the Messiah was going to work, and Jesus is gone. I would say they're on the brink of despair, would you not? I mean, brink of despair. They had plans, hopes, and they're left with nothing, right? Did you ever have a hard time believing in someone's story? Close your eyes for a moment. Indulge me for a minute. Did you ever have a hard time believing in someone's story? Did you deem the witness unreliable? Were the witnesses, were the people too young or too old? Was the person's past and the choices they made in their life, was that coloring your understanding, and so you had a hard time trusting their testimony? Or did you just make up your mind about something or someone? Did you think you had the truth and you knew what happened, even if you had not been present? You can open your eyes. So what if, as Mikkel Dinker has pointed out, that disciples cannot recognize Jesus because their opinions are fully formed? Fully formed. Fully formed. It's as if, even as they travel with Jesus, their minds are made up. So Jesus is with them, but they know the story. They've got it. Furthermore, Cleopas assumes Jesus is clueless, and that his cluelessness makes him a stranger, and not just a stranger, an outsider. Dinkler, in her commentary, points out that the Greek word for stranger is perikos. Oikos means house, so peroikos means outside the house. This is the same word used for someone who lives in a country with another citizenship. In essence, Cleopas and his colleague, companion, disciple, call Jesus an immigrant, foreigner, mostly because he doesn't know what's going on. He must be an outsider. The danger here of their assumptions is that Cleopas and the other disciple miss Jesus altogether. And not just Jesus, but everything the risen Jesus embodies. Hope, new life, the promise that pain and suffering and death are not the end of the story. So Dinkler, in her commentary that I used for today, she talked about this, and I was so persuaded, because isn't it true? It's like you've got this vision in your head and understanding, and even though this person is walking with you, granted, glorified body, transfigured, different, transformed, but you know the story. You know the story, and you're kind of stuck in Holy Good Friday or Holy Saturday. They're kind of stuck there, on the brink of despair, if not in despair. For me, it's as if Cleopas and his companion are still in the tomb. They're in the tomb. The irony here is that Cleopas cannot see, and he is describing on his journey to Emmaus, describing his dashed hopes to the very one who has fulfilled his hopes. Cleopas thinks he knows and understands, but like parables, he's as lost as ever, and he can't even see. He does not recognize this. But luckily, Cleopas and his companion, because of their intuition maybe, or commitment to hospitality, an important norm, or out of kindness, ask Jesus, stay with us. They asked Jesus to join them. Jesus acted as if he was going further, but they begged him, stay with us because it's getting late. Stay with us. I believe this invitation is the true turning point in the story. The true turning point. A moment full of grace. Cleopas and his companion invite Jesus to, in Kentucky terms, set a spell. They invite Jesus, stay with us. Now, if you'll forgive me, I'm going to digress a bit to the Tizay song, stay with me, remain with me, watch and pray, stay with me, stay with me, stay with us. With this invitation and then the meal and the breaking of the bread, suddenly their eyes are open, right? Now the disciples, they can see, and then he disappears, right? They see Christ of the resurrection. They see it now. Only afterwards do they say, weren't our hearts burning, burning within us as he talked with us on the road? Didn't our hearts burn? What a gospel story, huh? One of my favorites. My sisters and brothers, don't we all sometimes have fully formed opinions? I saw one nod. Aren't we like Cleopas and his friend? Don't we think we know the end of the story sometimes? And I think, I'm going to say for me, sometimes it's not about the resurrection and new life. Whether because of gun violence, or war, or poverty, or a political party, or oppression, or racism, you and I sometimes get lulled into believing we're doomed. But did you ever feel that way? Oh no, we're doomed now. Not that story. We're doomed. Is that what we are? As followers of Jesus, doomed? It's Easter, right? Look at what I'm wearing. It's Easter. Death does not have the last word. Death does not. Miracles can and do happen. But most of the time, those miracles involved our participation, our willingness to see, to see. We have to make the invitation, open the door, listen to the other, maybe even sign a petition or speak out. In the world we live in, how do we continue to be people of welcome and hospitality, even in a violent world? I heard Reverend Monica, all are welcome. If we follow the lead of the disciples, then we need to make an invitation. All are welcome. And you and I can miss that heartfelt connection because of fear. If we don't invite, because of worry and anxiety, especially if we've deemed the other an outsider, incapable of knowing what's going on or being trusted. Cleopas and his friend consider Jesus the outsider. Have you and I ever done the same? Outsider. Are we building bridges or walls in our life? What does it mean to be a disciple? Inviting Jesus in. Doesn't it mean that you and I daily, sometimes hour by hour, have to invite Jesus in? Stay with me, Jesus. Stay with us. We're here on Sunday, but if each day we wake up and say, stay with us, engage with Jesus in prayer, not only here, but at home. I think God wants all of us, all of us, and that can be scary. In the breaking of the bread, they saw him. Table fellowship, so essential, right? When we break bread together, when you do here, don't you see each other on a more intimate level? Don't you really see each other? I mean, you've been coming here, some of you, maybe for an entire lifetime. Don't you really see? Because you see with a different heart. It's not just Mr. and Mrs. or Sally or Joe. It's you see with the heart. You see one another. Let's face it. Do you ever invite someone to dinner? Don't you get to really see who they are? You really get to see them. And let's face it, don't you know that even in the best of times and the worst of times, if we see with our hearts, we do see differently. Not with eyes, with our hearts. I have a story I want to share with you that really illustrates this, a personal story that kind of brings it maybe here and now in a new way. And again, Regina, if I had known you, you would have been my sermon. Since my father died, my sister and I have been distant, I'm sorry to say. There's a lot more I can tell you about it, but the last 17 years, there's been a big silence between my sister Susan and myself. A deafening silence. Deafening. It's been like a wall that has been built between us that no one or nothing could penetrate. I think my opinion of my sister and hers of me have been fully formed. Fully formed. We had a history before my father died in 2005, but what we thought and understood of each other had been fully formed. I know you, Susan, and she'd probably say the same of me. I know you, Diane. And sometimes we didn't like what we saw. Can you relate? Last fall, my nephew got married, and we were invited to the wedding. Even with that wall between us, we got an invite. I was so excited, very excited. Did you ever step into a situation and suddenly your eyes were open? At that event last fall, I sat with my family. I sat at the table after the ceremony. My whole family was gathered together. This has been years since we've all been together in one room, my whole family. The walls started crumbling. Crumbling. My eyes were open. Karen, my other sister, looked across the dinner table. She saw my emotion. She saw my eyes filled with tears, and she said, "What's wrong?" I said, "We're all together. We're all together, and it feels so good again." I knew then there was no going back, only forward. I mean, let's face it, my mom had been praying since my dad had died that we'd all be together again. I don't really know what it was like for Cleopas and his companion, but I do think that Jesus' death was a game changer. And the walls of despair were just about in place. The walls of despair were just about in place. And despair ready to build a home in their hearts. When despair starts to build a home in us, it's hard to move, to love, to see. Then Cleopas and his companion asked Jesus, "Stay with us. Stay with us, Lord. Stay with us." I'm adding the Lord. Hey, stay with us. Grace, this is grace, pure grace. Grace, this is bubbled up, stay with us. Then sitting at the meal, they see. When we eat at the table here or gathered in sacred moments with neighbors, then we see, right? The people we misunderstood across the street or across the political aisle, the people we see or misunderstood in our own community, the people we see or saw or thought we understood, once we break bread, everything, the walls, we start to see them as brothers and sisters, companions on the journey. Breaking bread together, the world changes. The world changes for them, it changes for us. I have to say that things have changed in my family. And I told you, there's no going backward. There's no going back to the tomb. My sister finally came to Kentucky. I've been here 20 years. This is the first time she came to see me here in Kentucky. This is the first time that Susan and her family came and we broke bread together around the dining room table. My table in Lexington, nothing fancy. And suddenly I rediscovered my family yet again. My sister more alive, more loving, more beautiful than ever. My opinions that were fully formed were wrong. Her family was beaming. Now I see, and hopefully she sees too, Lyndhurst welcoming Jesus in the face of the stranger or a family member who we've disowned or who's disowned us. Welcoming Jesus in the face of the people we find most difficult is no easy task, not at all. Let's face it, we live in a broken world, and fear and hate often what we see. But if we break bread together with family or neighbor or the outsider or the stranger, God often does reveal God's self to us. And then we know and see God is with us and has remained with us and will remain with us. Our eyes are open, our hope and new life are ours. It's truly ours. We are the people of the resurrection, the resurrection. Regina will tell you. New life is ours now and forevermore. Amen. Alleluia.
Thank you, Diane. I'd like to ask you to share your joys and concerns with us this morning that we may include those in our prayers. Joys this morning. Yes, Eva.
I get to see my daughter this afternoon.
All right.
I haven't seen her in my
career, so. Excellent. Regina.
Just thank you for all the prayers that you sent for my family, watching over, helping me, and just the love of everyone.
We have been sending a lot of prayers and a lot of love your way. Yes, absolutely. And we're so glad you're here today. Diane?
I'd like to have a prayer of thanksgiving for Lyndhurst.
Okay.
And just the love and devotion and warm welcome.
All right. Thank you. Joyce? Oh, we got to have more joys than this. Come on. We have to be joyful. Yes, Debbie. Excellent. Yes, Nancy.
I had a joyful occasion last Wednesday was at Southwest Christian Chapel for Freedom Day's 100th birthday.
Ah, yes. Freedom McGee's 100th birthday.
Wow.
We were going to play a video for you and it wouldn't play this morning.
She played yes. Piano. She still practices.
Still practice every day. Wow. Rob.
I got to spend time with both Chet Ovington and Buddy Holthauser fishing yesterday, which was football.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. Okay. Concerns. Prayer concerns you'd like lifted in our prayers. Eva?
Ron's having a test procedure on Tuesday, so
okay, we're going to keep you in our prayers, Ron. Other prayer concerns? Sharon?
Well, I'd like to ask prayers for my nephew, Alex, who is trying for the fourth or fifth time to stay clean of drugs.
Okay.
And my sister and her husband are helping him again for the fourth or fifth time with some vocational education and opening their home to him. So we're praying that God will touch his heart and this time it will last.
We will pray for Alex and his parents. Absolutely. How is Sandy doing? All right. Okay. And how is Lisa and her daughters doing?
Her three daughters are doing good. Her youngest is 6 months doing.
Okay. Have they called in hospice or just given her bad news?
They're going to be sick.
Okay. We will keep them in our prayers. Prayer concerns, Rob?
For those living on the streets.
For those living on the streets. Gayan?
Yes, for the war that's occurring in Sudan and all the people who live there.
For the war in Sudan and, of course, the war in Ukraine. Yes. Diane?
For those with mental illness.
Mental illness. Yep. Okay. Let me pull up the words for our. Yes.
One more that is that the not only it's a joy and a concern, but the new mission of shoes and clothes for the healing place and for all of that.
All right. For our collection of clothes and shoes for the healing place and water steps. Okay. That is not coming up. Here we go. Let's try again. All right, here's our words. Blessings, we offer you our praise and thanks this morning. And in this moment of silence, please hear the names of people and places and things that we are thankful for this morning. Please help us turn our hearts and minds toward you and your vision for each of us, our congregation and our nation. Fill our hearts and minds with light and hope that we can contribute to the wholeness and healing of the nation and the world. Remind us that each small act of kindness and care can make a difference and impact someone's life in a positive way. We ask you this morning, gracious God, to hear our prayers for gatherings with family, for Regina and her family who are with us this morning, for Lyndhurst, for our congregation, for the people that come to worship in person and on Zoom, for those who are traveling this day. May your blessings be on each of us. The ministry that we do and the love that we extend to you and our neighbors. We pray for Diane. We pray for Frida McGee. We pray for opportunities to spend time with friends and to go fishing together. We ask your blessings upon us as we clean out closets to bring in clothes and shoes that we may support the healing place and water steps. We ask your blessings upon Ron as he has his test this week, upon Alex and his parents, upon Sandy and her family, upon Lisa and her daughters, and especially her youngest daughter. May your healing touch and your love surround them. Blessings upon those who are living in the streets, who are homeless, who need a safe place, and sometimes just need to be reminded that they too are beloved children of God. May your blessings be with the people in the Sudan where violence has broken out, and upon the people of the Ukraine who have lived so long with the war that's going on now. May your blessings and may your peace be in these places. We ask your blessings, gracious God, for people who are struggling with a substance abuse problem and their families. For people living with a mental health challenge and their families. For people facing surgery and healing from surgery and their caregivers. For people making difficult choices this week. For people who are grieving. And people celebrating a joy. And in this silence, gracious God, we ask you to hear the prayers of our hearts. And we ask you, God, to hear us as we pray together. Heavenly Father, Heavenly Mother, holy and blessed is your true name. We pray for your reign of peace to come. We pray that your goodwill be done. Let heaven and earth become one. Give us this day the bread we need. Give it to those who have none. Let forgiveness flow like a river between us, from each one to each one. Lead us to holy innocence beyond the evil of our days. Come swiftly, Mother, Father, come. For yours is the power and the glory and the mercy. Forever is your name, is one in all. Amen. We are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, people of generations before us who gave in faithfulness to God and to this congregation. Let us give with a joyful and generous heart this morning, that we may fulfill our mission in this community and beyond. Thank you for your continued generosity. And I invite you to join me as we pray for our offering. Loving God, we place our offering before you. We place our faith in you. We place our confidence in the Holy Spirit's power. We place our hope in the ministry of Christ Church. Please accept our gifts and our gratitude. Amen. So invite us to sing as our closing hymn, I'm So Glad Jesus Lifted Me.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad.
invite you to be seated. So what do we do now? This week, love your neighbor. Be kind. Express compassion and engage in prayer. So I have a few announcements to share. This week on Tuesday evening is the South Louisville Youth Center board meeting at 7 o'clock. On Thursday evening is the consistory meeting at 6:30. And then on April 30th, which is next Sunday, the Lyndhurst Community Outreach meeting will be immediately after worship at about 11:30 a.m.
And the association meeting next week at 3 o'clock at St. Andrew's.
Yes, that was next.
Sorry.
I did not forget.
Did you take me for an announcement?
Nope, just checking.
Sorry.
So next Sunday is the spring meeting of the Kentucky Anner Association, St. Andrew's UCC, 3 o'clock.
Come one, come all.
And next Sunday is also a One Great Hour of Sharing offering as well. So our mission project for spring is Spring Cleaning for Others. And we'll be collecting gently used women and men's clothing. The bins are in the hallway and the narthex under the mailboxes. If you can't get to church and would like to make a donation, Gay Ann will gladly come and pick up the items that you would like. So we encourage you to do a little spring cleaning this spring and fill our bins. And then Isabel, one of our scouts, is working on her Eagle project, and she will be collecting shoes for water steps. So all of the shoes that we collect over the next 4 weeks, we are going to give to Isabel for her Eagle project. Shoes can be in any condition. They can be the ones that have been sitting in the back of your closet for a couple years that you haven't tried on, or something brand new that you bought and don't like, and anything in between. So we encourage you to clean out your shoes as well and bring them to church, and they will be put to good use, and they'll help Isabel with her Eagle project. One of, I don't even know how many Eagles they've had in the short time that I have been here. So let's continue to support our scouts. All right. As you walk the paths of life, know that Jesus is walking with you, blessing you with his presence. And may the blessings of God Almighty, Creator Christ and Holy Spirit, be with you this day and in the coming week. Go in peace. Go be a light of hope. Go and serve in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be in our world.
And
I invite you again this week to rise and greet one another in the peace of Christ. And thank you for being with us today, Diane. Peace be with you.